The prayer for inner growth, Paul's prayer for inner growth, and writes to the church of Ephesus. And he's talking about praying for their inner growth. I mean, we talked a little bit last week about how growth is measured. How growth is a measuring tool. Growth is measuring tool, measuring the state. Growth isn't an identity or an identification or a label. Growth. How fast or how slow or how whatever rate of growth based on this, that, or the other. And how we use that, we might use that to correctly or incorrectly judge a person. I think of as far as growth, how human beings have growth spurts at different times in their lives. A person 10 years old might be their full grown height at 5'11". It happens. A person who's short all their life can have a growth spurt. David Robinson was 6'8" when he went into the Naval Academy and was 7'2" when he came out.
Wow.
Yeah. So growth is at that body's rate. But Paul is talking about inner growth, the growth that you can't see. He's talking about the growth that only God can see. He's talking about the growth that a mature eye, a mature mind is going to be able to see and rightly measure and be encouraged by and pour into and add to. That's the growth that can't be seen with the eye. It has to be seen with the spirit. It has to be seen and measured by the fruit of the spirit. It has to be measured by the word. It has to be measured in spiritual principle. That's what Paul is praying about for the church here in Ephesus. And I want to read through all 8 verses, and then we'll get into this. Again, Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 through 21. It says, "For this cause I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might by his spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and depth and length and height, and to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that ye might be filled with all the fullness of God. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we could ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Amen." And where we want to focus today is verses 18 and 19. Verses 18 and 19 says, and they're just continuations of this entire 8 verses. Is actually in its completion basically two sentences. Grammatically speaking, it's just two sentences. In verses 18 and 19, it says, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and depth, length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. But he's talking about, up in verse 17, that Christ may dwell in you, in your hearts, by faith, that ye, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend. So it's our desire, it's Paul's desire for us as the church, as he's writing to the church at Ephesus, but it's also the desire for us as believers that we be able to comprehend with all the saints. So this is for all the saints, not an elect few, not a select few, not an inner circle, so to speak, but this is for all the saints, that we would be able to comprehend what is the breadth and length and depth and height. The height of what? Semicolon there. Verse 19, and to know the love of Christ. So we have within us the Holy Spirit, that we be strengthened by might, by his Holy Spirit, in verse 16, in our inner man, because the Holy Spirit dwells within us. The inner man is our spirit, is our soulish realm. That's what God's looking to strengthen. That's what he's desiring to strengthen in us. But how are we strengthened in it? How are we strengthened by it? How are we strengthened? That ye, being rooted and grounded in love. We talked about that last week, being rooted and grounded in love. That we, being rooted and grounded, being rooted is being planted. That being, have those roots go deep down in the dirt so that we won't be swayed. Excuse me, that we won't be blown over. A tree will blow. There's trees, the tall trees, the small trees. When you see the wind blowing, the branches are doing their thing, but they're not being pulled out of the ground because they're rooted and grounded. Root because they're rooted. Grounded. Grounded is a solid foundation. Grounded. In electricity, in electrical terms, if it's grounded, it means you can't be shocked. Shockproof. Although I don't think Paul is talking in electrical terms, but I think it applies right here. Because if we're walking in love, and we went through 1 Corinthians chapter 13 last week talking about love and all those aspects of love, if we're walking like that in life, we won't be shocked by anything. There's nothing that'll come up and surprise us like that. But continuing, that we be rooted and grounded in love. So if we're rooted and grounded in love, love is the reason. Love is behind everything. Love is the greatest command, first of all. And in that carrying out, love is an act. Love is an attitude. An act and an attitude. Because of all the different things that love is and does in there. Love does not behave itself unseemly. That's an attitude. Love is patient and is kind. That's an act and an attitude. Patience is an attitude. Is kind is an act. So your actions and attitude. Love is an act and an attitude. By walking in love, that is how our inner man is strengthened, that we might be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and depth. Breadth and length and height and depth. Again, like we said last week, that's the full measure of love. Breadth, depth, height, and length. All four dimensions of love. That we understand the full measure of love. And that we know the love of Christ. that we have, that we comprehend the full measure of love, and that we know the love of Christ. Jesus said that I am come that you might have life, and that more abundantly. Life and that more abundantly, right? We'll get back to that. So, if he came that we have life, he says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. So, our life, Jesus is the life. He came that we might have life and that more abundantly. He came that we might have him and that more abundantly. We have the Holy Spirit within us, Christ dwelling within our hearts. That's what he's saying here, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that we be rooted and grounded in love, that we might know the breadth, that we might know the fullness, the full measure, the full dimension of love, that we might know the love of Christ. Quickly, Philippians 3 and 10. You don't have to turn there, but I'm going to read it aloud. Philippians 3 and 10. It says, that I may know him, this is Paul talking again, and he's talking about Christ, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto death, that I may know him in the power of his resurrection and in the fellowship of his suffering. So if we want to know Christ, what does it say? If you want to know somebody, know something about somebody, walk a mile in their shoes. So if we want to know Christ, we're going to know him in the fellowship of his sufferings. That's, I know that as a preacher, I know that that's not a popular concept to us as believers, because sufferings is not one of the things that we want to hear about as believers. We don't want to hear it about suffering. Yet the fruit of the Spirit includes long suffering. In the definition of love, love is patient and kind. It says love endureth all things. Patience, enduring, long suffering. Those aren't the messages that excite us. Those aren't the messages that put our shoulders back. Those aren't the messages that send us out ready to face the world. Those aren't the messages that do that. But here Paul is talking about knowing Jesus in the fellowship of his sufferings. But we have to, it's been prayed for us by Paul that we understand the breadth and the length and the depth and the height, and to know the love of Christ. Christ's whole life was about love. For God so loved the world that he gave his uniquely begotten Son. Christ loved us because God loved us. Christ loved enough that he gave his life for us. Christ loved us enough that he came down from heaven, put on sinful flesh, subdued that flesh, and then walked 33 years, 3 years in ministry, basically with almost every day of the ministry, going through everything that he did, Pharisees, Sadducees, the scribes, the Jewish leaders, almost everybody, that everywhere he went, somebody was there trying to trip him up. Somebody was there trying to confront him. Somebody was there opposing him. And then within the 12, you had a denier and a betrayer. And then in the moment when he gets arrested and begins the plan, there's nobody there with him. They all departed. Then he has to go and be falsely tried. Then he has to go and stand before a leader that says, hold the power of death and life over you. And Jesus, in his heart, mind, and soul, knows that that couldn't be further from the truth. Because we know from the word that he could have called 72,000 angels to come and end all of that. But his love for us was so great that he endured that. His love for us was so great that as they scourged him. And if we've seen the Passion of the Christ, the graphicness of that scene by itself. And everything that he went through. And then after that, you have the guards themselves coming out and inflicting their own. Weaving a crown of thorns. Braiding a crown of thorns. Beating it down on his head. Then they wrapped a cloak around him. And then bowed down to him, mocking him. He endured this suffering. A physical suffering. Mental suffering, it's suffering at every possible level as a human being. And it's multiplied because he is God. It's multiplied because he can stop this at any moment. It's multiplied because there was no reason for this other than our sin. Not his own sin, but our sin. But he endured this. Christ's love for us endured this. And that's how we know that the love of 1 Corinthians is a strengthening love. Because if it was about a warm, fuzzy love, that was gone. That had to have been gone at the first punch. That had to have been gone as a human being the first time somebody spat in his face. The warm, fuzzy, Hallmark, oh, friends forever, lovey-dovey, that love would have been gone and done with. And done with. Then you get these falsely tried. Then on the cross itself, and the two thieves on either, the thief on either side are railing on him, saying things against him, even though one had a change of heart. And Christ forgave him in that moment. So Christ endured. He endured his love. There's not one aspect of 1 Corinthians that he did not go through. In the entirety of the crucifixion experience from the garden, praying in the garden and having to come back and wake the disciples on two different occasions. Love is patient and is kind. He didn't chew them out. He didn't kick them out of the inner circle. Love is patient and is kind. Love endureth all things. Love beareth all things. Love, love, love. Love that calls his betrayer friend. At the very moment when he's carrying out that betrayal that called him friend. Love. Love. Love that was able to restore Peter, the denier. That restored him with such a surety to Peter. Strengthening him, encouraging him, and enabling him, tasking him even. Love that gave him such inner peace and strength that he is the speaker, the Pentecost speaker. Love endures. Love. Love never fails. And it wasn't because his outer man, it wasn't because his flesh was so strong because his flesh eventually died. His flesh, he eventually gave up the ghost. His flesh eventually could no longer withstand the beating and even the piercing of his side to ensure that he was dead. Love, it was the inner man, it was the soul of Christ, it was the inner part of Christ that allowed him to go through all that for us. It was the strengthened inner man of Christ that allowed him to endure even the very forsaking of God himself. We don't know how long that was. There's no time frame given. But we know that it was enough that Christ himself had to cry out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why hast thou forsaken me? He didn't say, why did you sacrifice? Because he knew why he was being sacrificed. And he knew that the forsaken was coming. Even in the moment, even knowing that it was coming, it was so great that the eternal, that up until the moment that he was birthed into this world, into flesh, that he rested within the very bosom of the Lord. But even up on the cross, having taken on every sin from the garden until his return, taking that upon himself, knowing that God himself can't face, can't exist in the place of sin. All sin was upon him. And God had to turn his back. But he endured that for us. He endured that for us. But that we might comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the depth and the height, and that we would know the love of Christ. Christ lived love. He lived love. Yes, he lived the 1 Corinthians 13 love in the face of every single person whom he encountered. He lived love. He lived love. And that's how, that's the expectation upon us, that we live love, that we are made in God's image, that we are after Christ, that we are Christians, that we are believers, that we are followers of Christ, that we are disciples of Christ, that we're going to live our lives in the manner in which Jesus lived his, then we ought to be living in love. And it is a difficult task. It is a difficult requirement. It was not easy for Jesus to go through that. Oh, but he was God. Yes, but he was God. Oh, but he was flesh as well. So that he could sit on the right hand of God and intercede on our behalf. Because nothing that we experience here on earth is going to be worse than what he experienced in any aspect, in the physical, in the emotional, in the spiritual. That nothing that we experience is going to be worse than what he experienced. So yes, he can have that expectation that we live in that manner. Yes, he can have that expectation that we're going to live love. Yes, he can have that expectation. That we would know the full measure, that we would comprehend the full measure, and that we would know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that we might be filled with all the fullness of God. That if we be filled with all the fullness of God, God is love. So if we be filled with love, we're filled filled with the fullness of God. Let everything we do, being rooted and grounded in love, love being the basis for everything that we do, love being the anchor for what we don't do, rooted and grounded in love, that we might comprehend the breadth and the length and the depth and the height, that we be rooted and grounded in it, so that we can comprehend it, and so that we can know it as Christ knew it. And this is a calling for us to get out of self, basically. But it's so hard. Yes, it is. But the reward is so great. But the reward is so great. Jesus said, "I am come that ye might have life, and that more abundantly." If we live love, if we live Christ, if we live our lives by the 1 Corinthians measuring stick, that is living life to the fullest. That is living life to the fullest. That is living life with no fear. That is living life with no limitations. That is living life with no limiter, with no throttle, with no inhibitor. That is living life to the fullness, that we might understand, that we might comprehend the breadth and the length and the depth and the height, that we might know the love which passes the love of Christ, which passes all understanding, that we might be filled with the fullness of God. And again, this is difficult because we spend a good portion of our lives trying to make sure that we don't get hurt. And that's a natural thing. Well, we have to overcome that. How do we overcome that? Love. Love for God first. That's why God says, "Love ye the Lord thy God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength." And if we're loving him with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength, if we're doing that for God, if we're living our lives in that manner, and God is in the center, and we're loving him with that fullness, then we need not fear. 365 times in the Word, God says, "Fear not." Once for each day of the year. Some versions, there's 366, so leap year is covered. We need not fear. If we're living by love, these three remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. So if we're living our lives by 1 Corinthians chapter 13, that's living the fullest life that we can live. Because we're not holding back for fear of getting hurt. Why is he not one of what's just the fear of getting hurt? Because our inner man is being strengthened by the Spirit. Verse 16, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory, by God's glory, to be strengthened with might. Strengthened with might. Might is another word for strength. Strengthened with strength. Strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man. And if our inner man is strong enough to endure all of that, then there's nothing that can come against the outer man that's going to fear. What's the hardest part of an egg? The outside. Because it has to protect what's on the inside, right? We're not eggs. We're not eggs. What's the hardest, strongest part of us? The inside. We're not eggs. We're not eggs. The strongest part of us is on the inside. So that no matter what happens to the outside, the inside is intact. The inside is strengthened. Mm-hmm. Strengthened in a manner that can't be deteriorated. Strengthened in a manner that can't be overwhelmed, strengthened in a manner that can't be gotten to by what? The canker worm, rust, or anything else. That our inner man is strengthened by might. With might, by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit dwells inside of us. And if we're believers, trust me, He does. Then we are able and capable of living, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, that we need not fear getting hurt by anyone. Jesus, all the exterior factors, the Jews, the Jewish leaders, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the scribes, everybody who came against him, they didn't affect him because the inner man was strong. They did what they wanted to. They did whatever they felt they could do to the outer man, but the inner man was so strong. That when the 12, his closest ones for 3 years, whom he poured into, when they didn't act right, he didn't get down because his inner man was strengthened. His inner man was strengthened. And of the 12, when one of the 12 became a betrayer, he wasn't down because his inner man was strengthened. When one of his inner circle became a denier, he wasn't down. He was able to forgive and restore because his inner man was stronger, was strengthened. So we got no excuse. Whomever comes at us, we respond in love. We respond with love. 1 Corinthians, love. It is patient. It is kind. It does not behave unseemly. It does not puff itself up. It does not. There's a lot. And we're strengthened to do that. Oh, but it's so hard. Oh, but it's so difficult. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. But Jesus said, I have come to have life, that you might have that. Have life, I have come that you might have life, and that more abundantly. What's the significance of that? Let's press on to verse 20. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly, I am come that you might have life, and that more abundantly. Now Jesus says, unto him who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we could ask or think, according to all the power that worketh in us, according to the power that worketh in us, power that worketh in us is love by the Holy Spirit, strengthening our inner man. He says, in us, again, not around us, not next to us, not above us, below us, in our direct vicinity, not circa, not any of that other stuff. The power that worketh in us. So God is able to do exceeding abundantly. Above that which we could ask, think, or imagine. I used to think that that was only applied to like prayer or our petitions before the Lord. But meditating here on this recently, God is showing me that there's so much more.
Yes.
This goes so much far, so far beyond what my prayer is, what my desire is from the Lord. This goes to me being able to stand in the midst of whatever may come. Paul, the same one who wrote in Philippians, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can face whatever situation that comes against me because of Christ who strengthens me. Because of Christ, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith. Through Christ who strengthens me. Again, through Christ who strengthens me. That glory to be strengthened by by his Spirit in the inner man. God is telling us, he's letting us know that what we have inside of us, there's a reason why the words is greater is he that is in you than he is in the world. Because all those things that are out there, all those things things that are out there working against us, trying to get us to keep our eyes, take our eyes off God, to become our focus. Giants that are out there that are trying to, you can't help but see a giant. You can't help but see a giant. Look at any picture, and whoever the tallest person is, they stand out. Right away, they stand out. Unless everybody's just picked within a 2 to 3 inch height range, you can't pick. But if you take a random sampling of people, somebody's going to be the tallest, without a doubt. Somebody's going to be the shortest. But giants are a distraction. Giants kept 10 spies from seeing grapes. Giants made 10 spies see themselves as grasshoppers. But guess what? To 2 spies, the giants weren't a distraction. You see, they were too focused on the attraction. The attraction was God's promise. This land. The attraction was this land God has promised. And they're looking at the land. So, because God promised it, whatever else was in there was immaterial. The giants didn't matter. That's why they were able to see grapes. Like, oh, we need to take this back as a sample to show everybody else. They weren't even concerned about the giants. Because God's promise, what was greater to them was God's promise. The fact that God had spoken. God said, I'm going to give you this land. So in their mind, this land is already ours. All we got to do is go in and take it. Because God's on our side. Because we're on his side. Because he has spoken this thing. So the giants, whatever God's going to do with the giants, don't know. Giants, y'all ain't got to go home, but y'all got to get out of here. Peace out to you. Because my God has spoken. It's not about me. And you're not my concern. My concern is getting you something grapes. You see? Think about it, though. Now, the giants. God has got all this delicacy laid out there. All this delicacy out there. And they're not even noticing because of the giants. Because of the giants. Look at how the enemy uses giants in our life. He tried to use giants. 10 spies going in God's name, and the giants got their attention. One giant taunting the entire army of Israel, telling them that the army of Israel let the giant decide. Okay, I'm coming out to fight. You guys send out your best soldier to fight me. Instead of saying, no, we're a mighty army. We got God behind us. You got to contend with us. You got to contend with God. But instead of doing that, they're like, oh, wow, our best soldier can't take him. So no, we good. Hold up. Just hold up. Let's sit here a minute. David comes in, he sees the giant, and all he sees, again, like I said last week, is opportunity. A giant is an opportunity. A giant is an opportunity to call on the Lord. A giant is an opportunity for God to show himself. A giant is an opportunity for us to turn to God, to remember who God is. And if our remember that we are strengthened by his spirit in the inner man. We're strengthened with might. Strengthened with might. Sometimes I watch the houses, like on HGTV, and they got when they're moving a load-bearing wall, and you got to put something in there you know, and the beam has to go all the way across, and like, well, we got to go to steel beam because this requires a lot of strength. They're not putting cardboard in there to strengthen that thing. They're not, you know, to go straight all the way across, if it's a long distance, it's got to be strengthened with steel. It's got to be strengthened with might. They're not putting more wood in there because wood's going to require additional, but they're strengthening it with steel. With steel. They're strengthening it with might. Think about ourselves strengthened with might, because we're not being strengthened. We can't be strengthened of ourselves. We can't be strengthened of anything of this world because it is insufficient. We have to be strengthened with might by the Spirit in the inner man. And it's interesting that it says by the Spirit, because by the Spirit, if the Spirit is strengthening us in our inner man, what is the Spirit yielding in us? The fruit of the Spirit. It takes strength to display the fruit of the Spirit, because the fruit of the Spirit isn't intended in our lives for those whom we get along with. It's not intended for those whom we get along with. We don't have a problem showing the fruit of the Spirit to those whom we get along with. That's low-lying fruit, if you will. That's the easy stuff. The fruit of the Spirit is for us to contend with sandpaper people, to contend with hard-headed people, to contend with argumentative people, to stubborn people. Obstinate, same thing as stubborn. You know, all those hard to deal with, get along with people in our lives. It takes strength to display the fruit of the Spirit. So we are strengthened with might by His Spirit, and everything that the Spirit brings in us, and everything that the Spirit wants to wrought through us, that Christ may dwell in our hearts. I shared last week about the same thing last week. Psalm 119, 9 and 11. How can a young man keep his way pure? By living according to your word. Verse 11. I've hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. I've hidden Christ in my heart that I might not sin against you. But because Christ is hidden in my heart, I am strengthened by His, I am strengthened by His Spirit. I'm strengthened with might by His Spirit in the inner man. That Christ may dwell in my heart in faith, being rooted and grounded in love. In love. Remembering what the greatest command is. If you can't remember any of the Ten Commandments, remember, love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul. Remember to love your neighbor as yourself. Remember to love your enemies. Remember to love. Because love is the way. Love is the way. We get to know Christ. We get to know the fullness, the breadth, the length, the breadth, the depth, the length, and the height of Christ's love through our sufferings. Because we're going to go through things. Because people are going to come into our lives. Because situations are going to come into our lives. But it's not the removal of those things that manifest the fruit of the Spirit. It's the enduring of those things. Why? Because 1 Corinthians 13 says love endures all things. But we're strengthened to endure those things. We are empowered, equipped, and enabled to endure those things. God doesn't expect us to do it on our own, because we cannot. We cannot. It is not possible that we live a life like this. It's not possible. It is not possible. That's why it requires us, as Paul said, now unto Him that is able to do exceeding abundantly. Exceeding abundantly. Abundantly, there's abundantly. Plenty. More than enough. Christ says, I have come that you might have life, and that more abundantly. More abundantly. Okay? So, and then it comes to, now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly. More abundantly, exceeding abundantly. Where else in this world where if you where abundantly, if you just stop at abundantly, that's limiting? Two places in the word, exceeding abundantly and more abundantly. God is able. Christ said that he came to whom I had a life and have that more abundantly. We just need to live love. God's already strengthened us. He has strengthened us that we continually to be strengthened with might by his spirit. To be strengthened. His spirit is in us as believers. So we've been strengthened. We're continually being strengthened. The more we live love, the more we go through, the more we practice love, the more we do love. I wasn't going to read through it, but I'm going to read through it. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. I'll start with verse 4. And again, read from the King James Version. It substitutes charity for love, but it's the same thing. Charity suffereth long. That's that one. It opens up with that. The least favorite, the least popular of all. Charity suffereth long, comma, and is kind, semicolon. So these two are grouped together. Suffereth long and is kind. Suffereth long and is kind. Misery loves company. That's what the world says. Misery loves company. That's what the world says. The word says, love suffereth long and is kind. Love envieth not. It vaunted itself not. Is not puffed up. It does not behave itself unseemly. Does not seek her own. Is not easily provoked. And that's my ouch. Love thinketh no evil. Rejoices not in iniquity, but rejoices in truth. Bears all things, believes all things. Does not say that we are gullible and we just fall for somebody coming trying to sell us the Brooklyn Bridge. No. No, it does not. But it's saying that we don't walk around with the heart and mind of a skeptic. That even when people just come to us telling us their story, the Holy Spirit is going to lead. He's going to lead us. But if we look at every little thing and we see the conspiracy behind it, if we look at every little thing and we're picking it apart because that's not what we would do, because that's not how that ought to be done, because, no, love believeth all things. We're not called to be gullible, no. Love hopeth all things. Love endureth all things. Whatever it is that we're facing, that God needs us to go through, love endures all things, just like Christ endured the crucifixion experience. With the inner man being strengthened, what? With might by the Holy Spirit that is in us, that Christ may dwell in us, so that we can know the breadth, the depth, the length, and the height of his love, know the full measure of what they're talking about right here. Love endures all things. Christ prayed, and he didn't pray that we be removed from this world, but we that we be what? Never mind. In his prayer, he says, I don't pray that you remove them, take them out of this world. But his prayer was that we be strengthened in this world. And here it is, verse 8. Charity never fails. Love never fails. Love never fails. We can't go wrong loving. We can't go wrong walking by love. What does it say?
I pray not that thou should take them out of the world, but that thou should keep them from evil.
Keep them from evil. How is he keeping us from evil? Strengthening us. Strengthening us with might by the Spirit. The Spirit's going to keep us from evil. Christ in our hearts is going to keep us from evil. So Jesus didn't pray that we be taken out of this world, but that we be able to kept from evil, that we be able to endure the things that life is going to throw at us. Life has a full bag. Life has curveballs. Life has all this other stuff that is going to throw at us. The kitchen sink. But we're what? We are strengthened in our inner man with might. We're strengthened with the right stuff to be able to endure. It would be wrong of God to say to endure all these things, but not equip us and enable us to do so. He's not that God. He's not that God. Whatever he expects of us, he's equipped us, enabled us to do. Equipped us and enabled us to do. And I ended in verse 8. Love never fails. And that's right where I'm going to stop with that. Love never fails. Because love never fails. Love never fails. Love never fails. God is too good. He's too wise. He's too all-knowing to set us up to fail. He has set us up to succeed. He's set us up to endure. I'm going to read through it one more time. For this cause, I bow my knees unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye being rooted and grounded in love may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and the depth and length and height, and to know the love of Christ, which passeth knowledge, that ye may be filled with all the fullness of God, now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, unto him be glory in the church, by Christ Jesus, throughout all ages, world without end. Amen. Amen. And that is our word for the day. Let's give God some praise.